Hollywood.
Wow.
So.
But the industry's changing.
Let's hope so.
Old systems are going away.
Are you hopeful?
Totally. I'm so excited. Are you kidding me? When I started in this industry, there were so many films. I remember I finished, it was like after Zero Dark Thirty, I would get these scripts. And a couple times, there was one film I was going to do with Luca, actually, which was a great script, female protagonist, but was told they couldn't move forward until they cast the male actor. There's twice that happened to me. And I was also told that right in the beginning when I was coming into the industry, that they didn't want to make films with female protagonists because they didn't think they were financially viable.
So I've seen
a change in the industry. I will say that. I've definitely seen a change in the industry.
So you're not getting that note anymore?
No, because I was like, all right, well, then I'm not even going to talk to y'all. If you're going to wait to cast the male actor, then, you know, don't bring it to me.
Well, so funny thing about it, because I mean, over these last number of years, there've been still having conversations. It hasn't turned into the drama it has in the last few months.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a lot of it, I felt like, you know, if your agent is doing this thing to you that you think is so terrible, why do you still have that agent? You know, like, you seem to have taken a much more proactive position. Meryl Streep has taken a proactive position and works primarily with female directors now.
Mm-hmm.
It's very rarely that she works with a male director at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Where, you know, there's just, you make the choice and you actually do something.
Yeah.
Instead of talking.
Yeah, I mean, if you're part of, for me, it's always been, if you're part of the industry, you're part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And now too, especially with everything that's come out and come forward, I believe that your inaction makes you complicit. So even if you're not involved at all,
right,
if you're just doing nothing in an industry that there's incredible abuses of power, you're complicit. Because you need to be doing whatever you can to eliminate those abuses.
Well, that's been one of the more frustrating things about this whole Harvey Weinstein thing and everything out of it, is how many people are pretending they don't, you know, we didn't know anything, we didn't know this, we didn't know that. And everybody, I mean, they say everybody knew, and not everybody knew, but people knew.
People knew.
It was not a shock. I mean, this makes Quentin look brave to actually come out and say he knew and that he should have done more.
Mm-hmm.
But there are not enough people, I think, taking that position.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I think to the extent, of course, no one knew what was happening behind closed doors. But I can tell you as an actress, actresses and actors, we all talk to each other. And we're a great community of people that protect each other. And there are many instances when the beginning of my career where actresses would say, be careful around so-and-so.
Mm-hmm.
So for it to be such a shock, or you know, people, and I think it's so much has unfolded in the last month. I don't think anyone can really say that they're shocked by the industry. It goes back to Louis B. Mayer, Jack Warner, Fatty Arbuckle. I mean, this is not an industry that has been wonderful to women in the past.
No, there's actually a great documentary from about 5 years ago.
Girl 28.
Yeah.
Incredible documentary. I think it's required viewing for anyone who wants to work in the industry.
Well, I think we actually need to like revive some of those movies. There's an Amy Berg documentary about grooming children, Open Secret.
Yeah.
That just nobody wanted any part of. They were four-walling it, I think.
Yeah, and I heard there was a version that showed in Sundance, and then like 1/3 of it was cut out.
Yeah. No, there was definitely a fight between Amy and the producer who kind of took it away and had to do their own thing. But the idea that people are so afraid of even discussing it is
hideous. I think the greatest myth that I think any industry perpetuates is that women are replaceable.
Mm.
And I think you have to, and it's something that happens from a very early age. You kind of, you know, it's like, it's a grooming of that where you're led to believe that you should be grateful just to have a job and to keep your mouth shut and you're easily replaceable and all of that, instead of going, actually, I have something to offer to this world and I've worked really hard and, you know, studied and no one's easily replaceable with their skill set. So I think that's a myth that we're starting to look at, and women are starting to examine in their themselves and realize that, like, there's some great actresses who, like, look what Reese Witherspoon has done.
Yeah.
Right? You know, she turned 35, and then immediately her career just completely took off on her own volition.
Yeah. Well, she became a serious producer, as Nicole has, and...
Absolutely.
You know, so are you heading in that direction, do you think?
Absolutely. I've become less interested in acting in a strange way. I really enjoy it, but I also really enjoy the performances of other people. Like, I love watching Idris in this film. I did a movie, Woman Walks Ahead, and for me, I love Michael Grey-Eyes in that film, and I'm so excited for people to see his performance. And so the idea that I created a production company, and I'm really excited and inspired by creating opportunities for underrepresented voices in our industry. Because acting always, for me, it's been an exercise in empathy. You get to walk in another person's shoes for a while. But how can this industry show that? How can you learn empathy when you're looking at someone on the screen who looks just like you? Mm. Right? We need inclusion. And it's a great passion of mine, and it might even be a greater passion than acting. So we'll see where my life leads me to that.
I just occurred to me that I should look in the lens and make sure that you're actually completely focused.
Oh, no!
Great moments in American history. And you look great, and then I realized that I hadn't actually even done it because you had your people around you, that I hadn't actually zoomed in and made sure you were 100% perfectly clean. Okay, you were.
Okay, good. That's funny.
No, yeah, painful and funny. I become much more.
Did
like
you have
a
that pit
show.
In your stomach where you're like, oh gosh?
You have those moments where you're like, did I turn on the camera? definitely turn on the camera, but I've become more of a one-man band because I like it, and then things happen and I forget.
Yeah.
It's rare, but when it happens, it's very painful. In any case, so your focus will be on expanding the universe, not just finding good material for boys, or do you care even?
For boys?
If you find something good for male actors and...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I want also, there's a, I don't want to say what it is because I haven't bought the rights yet, but there's these incredible books that I'm reading, and I'm interested in Asian American stories, I'm interested in indigenous stories. For me, it's not just women. I'm interested in, like I said, all underrepresented voices because I want to learn about people. And the only way I can learn about people is learning about those that are different than I am.
And I've noticed that on your Twitter feed, that the infamous Twitter that is Twitter these days, but one of your consistent things has been that you've been mostly supportive of people who've spoken out.
Yeah.
You kind of seem to be there to encourage and to say, I hear you, I believe you, thank you.
Yeah, it's important to me because when I said earlier that our inaction makes us complicit, right? So if we're silent, if we're not using our voices to amplify those that are so, those people who have come forward have done something so incredibly courageous. It doesn't matter how long it took them to come forward. And there's so many people that haven't come forward because they have been absolutely destroyed and afraid because society tends to blame victims. They've come forward only to protect others. And that kind of courage and that kind of bravery, it humbles me. And I believe it's my responsibility to use whatever kind of platform I have to amplify their strength.
So the platform today is Molly's Game.
Let's do it.
Let's do it. Let's talk about Molly's Game. It's always fun. It's always a funny turn, but it's not, you see it coming. So it's like I feel like I'm pitching to somebody who knows how to hit every ball out of the park. So how did this start for you? Did Aaron just call you? And?
No. It started, my agent, Hilda Queeley, talked to me. That she said there was a script. She knows that I'm very interested in political filmmaking. Aaron Sorkin, he's a political filmmaker. He is someone, he's all about social commentary. He's a great thinker, a great writer from the beginning of his career with A Few Good Men. He is someone who has been out there. His filmmaking, for me, is about social justice. It's about that good will prevail against the odds. even in a world where we have Trump. You know, there's an optimism to his writing, and it's inspiring, and it's a voice that I've really has kind of like fueled me forward in my life. And so when she called me about his script, I was really excited. But more than excited about working with him, when I read the script, there were so many layers to what's going on in society. I'm just gonna be honest, as a very successful, Aaron Sorkin is a very successful white man who's interested in making his directorial debut. He could have written and told any story he wanted. And he would have gotten financing, he would have gotten funding, everyone would have paid attention, everyone would have been excited about an Aaron Sorkin story. And he decided to tell this story. Mm. And there are so many filmmakers that I admire and just I want to work with so bad that have long-spanning careers. And I look at their IMDb and I go, they've made this amount of movies. How many of those films have female protagonists? And it's soul-crushing, it's heart-crushing. Because you think, why aren't they interested in stories about women? Because I love these filmmakers. So for
People do make movies about what their story is a lot of the time.
But isn't that what contributes to exclusion?
Well, if you're only making a story, filmmakers, but also there should be more male filmmakers. There definitely should be more male filmmakers making films about women. But I'm just saying that if you look at somebody like a Spielberg, mm-hmm. who's had this kind of amazing run, and has actually made a few women movies about women that have mm-hmm. had women leads, but not a lot, mm-hmm. or Scorsese, or that they tend to be in a pocket that's kind of their pocket. And it's hard to get them out of it.
Right, but I think the great thing about being an artist is looking at the life around you, right? And if your pocket is so small, I think that limits your artistry. You know, Aaron's talked about this film, and he's talked about how he sees himself in Charlie Jaffe, the lawyer, mm-hmm. in the script, and this whole thing about him judging Molly from the beginning, and like this whole kind of evaluation of where women sit in the world, and that to me is really exciting. He could have, he knows, Aaron Sorkin loves baseball. He loves sports. He's more obsessed with that than anything else. He could have made a movie like that. Yeah. It would have been very comfortable, and he would have been in his zone. But I'm excited with like painters, with musicians, with dancers and filmmakers and writers who make more than one movie.
Right.
They go outside their individual experience and discover the world. And that's really exciting to me, and any kind of art form.
Well, Luca's certainly one of them.
Sorry, who'd you say?
Luca, you mentioned
Luca,
earlier.
Luca, absolutely.
Xavier Dolan.
Well, another. All the great filmmakers that I'm really inspired by are ones who explore humanity. And humanity is more than just your own existence. Mm.
And for you as an actress, I guess it gives you, you know that there's going to be room to work as a,
yeah, but
and
I'll,
you're going to be a priority in terms of storytelling.
Yeah, but I'm not interested.
Your character is.
Yeah, if you're doing a movie about women. But like I said, in my production company, I'm not interested in creating projects just for me. This isn't something that's like, I need more work. So right. This is what needs to happen.
I don't think you need more work.
I don't. I'm good. But like I said, I may decide tomorrow that I'm done acting. But I feel like that's going to be okay because my passion may lie elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And for me, this is more about being, I'm so excited by people. I'm so excited by, I want to learn as much as I can about a stranger. And so I'm not looking at it like inclusivity is good because it's going to be good for me.
Right.
I'm looking at it, it's going to be good for me as the audience member.
So was this something that was true of you when you were 20 years old and going to school, or is this something that you figured out a few years ago and or in recent years?
You know, it was, I will say this, I went to a Juilliard reunion recently, and I was reminded of really early on, I noticed the discrepancy in gender at school. I don't think it's like this anymore, but when I was there, there were like 8 women, and which was the most women that they had ever had, I think, and like 14 men in our class. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like a third women. And all the other years had even less women. And I went to the head of the program and I asked them, I was like, why do you guys bring in so few women into the program? It's wrong. You know, like, why isn't it 50-50? And his response was, well, it's what the parts are. You know, if you look at the classics, you look at Shakespeare, if you look at the plays that we're going to end up doing, there are more male roles. And I thought, well, that's just the circle continuing. How do we get history to move in a straight line, not like boop, boop, boop? I said, well, how do you expect to change it if you don't allow more artists in? Because women can play male roles, we can write more plays, we can, you know, there's a lot of other things we can do. So I do think at an early age, I did notice, I don't like any sense of something not feeling right in the room. I don't like a sense of it just being one demographic. And so I've perhaps had that for a while.
Mm. But in terms of your acting, did you reach a point where you were at peace, where the idea of, okay, maybe this isn't the key thing in my life or the central thing in my life for my entire life?
Absolutely. You know, I was talking to someone recently, an actress who's been, I know a lot of actresses who have been in the industry for a long time, you know, even as children. And I know a lot of really horrific stories about their experience, kind of like the majority of their lives being in this industry. And I realized, I was talking to someone yesterday and I said, you know, I came into this industry as an adult, right? I had gone to school, I kind of already knew who I was. I had 7 films the first time, like I was doing interviews, I like had all my films. So by the time I was meeting people who had reputations for being a bully, I didn't need them. I didn't need to like garner, you know, oh gosh, I'm afraid of, you know, that they're not gonna cast me. I kind of like came in going, I feel like I know who I am, here's my work, and I had that sense. And so my heart goes out to a lot of people who have spent so much time in the industry that I feel like there's some kind of grooming that goes on.
Well, there's that fear, that initial fear. I mean, the stories that have come out from the male side of it are so kind of, besides being bad, are also disgusting. From a male perspective, I mean, the idea that there's so much about self-pleasuring and everything, and not about, it's not like they're trying to get anything other than some sort of power and personal redemption. It's not really, it's a very strange, sick desire.
Yeah.
It's not like they're, you know, it's not like the guy who slept with every actress he ever interviewed or whatever. It's not even a casting couch.
It's power.
It's more than that. It's clearly something going on.
It's all power. Whenever you have one demographic that is in charge of of minorities' livelihoods, you're going to have abuses of power.
But the men who are actually looking for this seem to be like trying to fill a giant hole in themselves that has nothing to do with it. It's not just, you know what I mean? Like Daryl Zanuck seems to me like those stories are about power and send the girl down to my dressing room or whatever. The Harvey stories and the Toback stories, they're all just such self-loathing in them.
But I think
it has the same effect on the women.
Yeah, but isn't that the age-old story of what the bully is?
Yeah.
The bully hates themselves more than they hate anyone else.
Yeah.
You know, it's the compassion for that. So I think anyone that abuses another person has a huge hole in them, you know? And the way that they try to cover up those feelings of self-loathing are through power and through success and through the sense of being seen as strong. But so you have to also, you have to look at a society that also creates that. Someone sent me like 4 days ago, I think I posted posted on Twitter, like the screenshot of the definition of patriarchy. And I don't know why I never really examined that word and the idea of patriarchy in family and industry and in politics. And you realize that's our world, absolutely. We don't acknowledge that. And also, that's Molly's world in this film. And the idea when we were talking about Aaron using his power to examine that, to examine what happened to her in her family, in her industry, in the government. This idea of this woman trying to navigate herself to find success in an industry where rich, powerful men made all the rules and the rules changed depending on their whims, is something we can look at for Hollywood and what's going on right now, but we also should look at for the administration. We should look at for Wall Street. It's really inspiring to me, and it's why I want to be in this industry and work with people who are political filmmakers and not someone who just says, we're here for the ride.
Right.
He's someone who's like says, okay, what can we do to make the world run in a more healthy way?
Well, Molly also sets a standard for herself from pretty early on. I mean,
I disagree.
Yeah?
I disagree. I think at the end of the film she does. But I think during the majority of the film she gives herself away. So from, you know, we see in the very beginning with her family, her dad's the moral authority of the film, and she says, well, can I disagree with you? And he says, when you make your own money. She goes, okay. So she goes to work in this industry where all these men are kind of in charge of her livelihood, and they say, ugly dress, ugly shoes. So she says, I went and I changed everything about the way I looked. I said, give me something that made me look nothing like myself. So then she dresses in a way that hopefully she thinks makes her valuable to those men, so they will see her, so she won't be invisible. The rules change for her there. Then, with the government, excluding Charlie Jaffe, because he, like I said, he's like the Aaron Sorkin kind of observer, with the government, the rules change. You know, if you give us the juice, we'll give you your money back, which is why they took it in the first place. And it isn't until the end of the film where she says, I'm not going to play by those rules anymore. This is what I believe. This is what I'm going to do. Of course, it happens after a scene where she realizes and her father apologizes for being a hypocrite, not the moral authority. Charlie Jaffe has gone from the beginning of when he meets her, him also saying, you got to change the way you're dressing. I mean, all these ideas of like what women have to do for men to see them and value them for not the way they look, but like to actually hear what they say. I don't think it's until the end. I think Molly makes a ton of mistakes in this movie. And at the very end is the first time she doesn't make a mistake.
Well, certainly mistakes, but there is also some sort of, she does seem to have a degree of self-empowerment in the midst of it. Besides obviously making money and all of that, she's a parent in that room a lot of the time.
Yes, but she becomes a drug addict. She also gets in a situation where she's mixed up with the mob. You know, she's in the room and she knows she has to figure out how to deflect the sexual advances of men without insulting them because they're her clients and they need to come back. I mean, she's still kind of tiptoeing around those rooms. And there's a huge emptiness that she feels and that I think when we start to see her spiral with drugs, with this emptiness that she's feeling when she realizes she doesn't really know what she's accomplishing in this world.
So is that what's the most interesting to play?
For me, what was the most interesting to play, because when I got the script, I was like, whoa, this is incredible. I can't believe Aaron Sorkin wanted to tell this story. And what was the most interesting thing to play is after meeting Molly and doing research, and I met the players who played with her in the games, and they took me to a New York game, and I sat in the room with all those guys. And for me also, what was really important was the physical transformation. And of course, that's not written out so much in the script. The script gives you little signpost clues. You know, I look nothing like myself or like that. But as a woman, I kind of knew what that is. You know, the whole red carpet, you know, this whole thing of what it is in society, how we know. And I was excited to bring that into the film.
Cleavage is a big part of this film, more so than I think any other film.
And you know, someone sent me this thing where like a lot of comments on the trailer were talking about my body, which is so interesting because it really goes to show in our society, and it's a lot of the point of the film, women are valued for their sexual desirability and not for what they say.
Well, it's tricky too because they have to sell the movie.
Yeah,
and that's like, is that part of the sell, or are they, you know, it's like a very tenuous, weird thing.
But also too, it's a situation like if you're going to, I mean, I don't know, I didn't decide to dress like that to sell the movie.
I'm sure, obviously not.
For me, it was important to. I have pictures of the Kardashians all over my trailer. I'm interested in examining society that looks at women as disposable objects, and I know it was really important to show that physical transformation for Molly, in the terms of the way that someone would actually pay attention to her in those rooms, is she had to change what she looked like.
Well, I guess there's a long movie history of the Madam character. Yeah. Which is kind of what she is, and they, you know, always Dolly Parton with a, even pushed up Dolly Parton is kind of part of the design of that character. It's always somehow sexiest girl in the house.
But this was not an Aaron sort. It wasn't a situation where Aaron said to me, you need to dress in this way. It was definitely, I was going to a New York game, calling Aaron the next day, like, the girls in the room, they wore bandeau dresses. And he was like, I have no idea what that is, but sure, do it. You know what I mean? So for me, especially for women in society, a woman should dress in any way she wants to. As little, like, she can show whatever about her body she wants to show. She can cover up as much as she wants to show. But whenever society is telling her what she should be looking like, how much sex she should show, I think that's when we've gotten into an issue. And the film does that twice. The players tell her she's not attractive enough. She needs to show more skin. Mm-hmm. And Charlie tells her she's showing too much skin. It's like... You know, it's a really interesting dynamic that Aaron Sorkin was able to write about.
And how do you feel about the powerful self-exploitation of the Kardashians and people like them? Is that...
I don't judge them at all. I have no... Because, honestly, being a woman, you understand what a woman's journey is. And that's how, actually, when I first saw Molly, I kind of like, okay, I don't really take her... I don't know, I kind of prejudged her. And then I got to know her and realized, wow, why am I judging her? And I realize maybe I'm falling into this trap of how the media is presenting people. I don't judge anyone who is trying to find some sense of power in an environment where their gender has been denied it. Mm. Not at all. Like in our film also, Charlie judges Molly, and it's his daughter who's the one who says, no, look at her. Because, like I said, only a woman understands what it's like to be a woman in this society.
Well, she also answers the questions. I mean, Molly does make decisions that put Charlie in a position to believe her, to believe in her.
Oh, totally.
But her consistency is remarkable in terms of that.
Remarkable, but also, too, in most cases, we see the gossip and we go, ugh, and we kind of, like, throw them away. Right? This kind of, you know... it's the whole thing we were just talking about, like blaming victims, blaming... Someone wrote this amazing piece, this of like, whenever anything happens, where's the woman we can blame for it? And Charlie, when he sees her, he goes, this is not... I know who you are, lady. I don't want anything to do with it. And then he starts to, because of his daughter, he starts to kind of go, well, wait, let me make sure I'm right about this. And the more he gets to know Molly, he realizes he was wrong.
Everything is disposable now. I mean, that's the thing that's horrifying. My biggest fear about the whole Weinstein drama is that it's disposable, and that 6 months from now we won't be talking about it, when we really need infrastructure and ways to, you know, rules need... This needs to be discussed in such great depth.
I think social media has changed the world. There's some scary things that have happened because of social media, but it's an incredible equalizer of power. In that, in the past, media, like, you know, history books, media would focus on what they wanted to focus on. And now with social media, everyone has a platform. So I believe the reason why this has really come forward the way it has is because of social media. An article came out on October 5th, and people were emboldened by to felt like safe that they could come forward with their stories because of the support that they saw around them on social media. So for me, I don't think it can be like it was in the past. I think where we're heading now is those that throughout, you know, in history have not had a voice have a voice. Mm. And we can watch videos of what's happened. It's scary. Especially as an actor, it's scary because it can be such an invasion of privacy when you think, oh gosh, someone could be taking a video of me outside my house or whatever. But I am supportive of it because I'm excited that someone could shine the light on an injustice that would have been ignored. When you look at different news organizations that didn't do their best to deliver stories.
Well, I think that's certainly true. I think there's a weird schizophrenia, I guess, in the idea of how, I mean, the New York Times story wouldn't have run if it weren't for Ashley Judd coming forward, and she wasn't directly assaulted. She was obviously harassed, but she was not assaulted. But, and yet everything else that's come that's much more severe, much more dangerous, has been a direct result of that.
That bravery of Ashley Judd.
And that relatively small, you know, it wasn't Rose McGowan coming forward. It wasn't Asia Argento coming forward. It wasn't somebody who had been raped and who had, you know, been through that directly. It was the least of the stories, but at least putting her name to it changed the entire universe instantly.
Mm-hmm. I think women have realized, you know, in the past that those in power have tried to divide and conquer, right? That's throughout history. That's what kings would do. You divide and that and you conquer. And women, with the Hillary Clinton and the Women's March and all this, are starting to realize that we're there for each other and we protect each other. And no matter what is being put out there, I don't think it can be a situation where we're divided again. So that's what makes me hopeful. I mean, when I saw that and I saw that Ashley Judd was putting herself out there, I was like, October 5th, the day the article came out, I was there. I retweeted and I made sure I contacted her. I think we need to do that.
And we're hoping Molly's Game will continue that conversation.
I think it should. I hope Molly's Game. The thing is, perhaps those dresses will bring in an audience that, and this is not what I was thinking, you know, because for me it was about playing a character in the reality. But who knows, maybe an audience that hasn't really thought about gender in society is now going to have their eyes open to it. And that's, I mean, what better way to be an artist?
And the ambiguities of the story are, you know, really critical to it being more than just, it's not just a hero story, it's a fallen hero, a rising hero. She goes through so much stuff that it's really a conversation.
And no matter how many times she gets knocked down, she stands right back up.
Yeah. Which is not just easy, it's a conversation.
It's definitely. And it's Aaron Sorkin, who I believe is our greatest writer, because he starts those conversations.
Thank you for your time. Good to see you.
Thank you.
I didn't even get to wish you a happy marriage or whatever. You got married
thanks.
Since I saw you last. Congratulations.
I know. Thank you very much.
It was a life-changing event.
Yeah, wonderful event.
Thank you.
All right. So that was just like light talk.
They have another light conversation, yeah.